discussed about the price elasticities of demand and supply curves. And similarly, we have seen the constant price elasticities of demand and supply, and we have seen the problems related to those one. And today we will be starting the method of estimating the demand function. So we will be having a demand function, right? So but how to estimate that demand function? So there are two methods for estimating the demand function. The first one is Leontief's method, and the second one is Peikert's method. So these two methods are very important from the exam point of view also. So coming to the methods of estimating the demand function. So for estimating the demand function, first we need the data, right? So without data we cannot estimate or fit the demand function. So that data, how to collect the data for the demand function is, there are two methods. First one is family budget method, and the second one is the time series data. The data is the first one, family budget data. So here family budget data means it is a survey method. So here the households will be selected first. So we will, the investigator will be going to the each and every household and collect the information. So based here, while selecting the households, it should be keep in view that all the types of income groups and all the types of families, that is low income, high status, low status, and the different localities, all the families should be selected equally and surveyed on them to get the information. So that is family budget data. And coming to the time series data, this time series data is also called as the market data. So in a particular market, in the daily basis, what are the different prices of different commodities? So we will be obtaining the prices of the different commodities from the markets. That is called the time series data. That means we will be having the past data, present data, all those market values, market prices and market demands. Everything will be collected from the market. So that is called the time series data. So we will be fitting the estimating the demand function based on the time series data. So based on the time series data, we are going to estimate the demand function. So what is the first method is? First method is Leontief's method. Demand and supply curves given us. So first we'll write the demand curve. What is the demand curve we have written? X equals to Cp power minus alpha. So here I'm taking D equals to Cp power minus alpha. So this is the general demand function at constant price elasticity. So we will be writing demand and supply. So what is the supply function? S equals to Cp power alpha. So here we have two values, so that's why we will consider here C1, here C2, alpha 1 and alpha 2. So this is the demand function at constant price elasticity, and that is the supply function at constant price elasticity. Now if we apply log on both sides, so what will we get? Log D equals to, this is in the form of log A into B, so that can be written as log A plus log B, log C1, and this can be written as plus of log A power M again minus alpha 1 into log B. So this is the log D value. Similarly, if I apply log to this, what I will get? Log S equals to log C2 plus alpha 2 into log P. So this can be written as log D, I am writing as Yt equals to log C1, I am writing as Ut plus eta 1 Xt. This one I am writing as Yt equals to log C2, I am writing as Vt plus alpha 2, I am writing as beta 2, log P is as it is Xt. So these are the demand and supply curves we got after applying the law. So this one you write it as equation 1 and this one you write it as equation 2. So now the next step is, here why we took Yt for both demand and supply curves? Because at a particular price, that is at the equilibrium price, we are considering the market data, right? That is time series data means market data. So in a market, the price settles down. So at some point, we will get an equilibrium price. That is both demand and supply will be equal. So that's why even for demand curve we took Yt and for supply curve also we took Yt only. So after this, the next is, what are the eta 1 and eta 2? We know that eta is the price elasticity. So eta 1 is the price elasticity of demand and eta 2 is the price elasticity of supply. So coming to Ut and Vt. So this Ut and Vt are independent of each other. Ut and Vt are independent of each other. So if Ut and Vt are independent of each other, with the condition is given that the expectation of Ut equals to 0, similarly expectation of Vt equals to 0. So since if they are independent, why? Because if they are independent, the covariance term will be 0, right? So if the covariance term is 0, means expectation of, what is the generally expectation of x into y equals to expectation of x into expectation of y. So if covariance is 0, means this term will be 0, that is the expectation of x will be 0, our expectation of y will be 0. Now, from this equations 1 and 2, we get, from 1 and 2, we get, so here I am writing the equations in terms of Ut and Vt. So, This is equation 4. Now what we have to do is multiply equation 3 and 4. Multiply 3 and 4. So if we multiply 3 and 4, what will be getting? You will multiply LHS separately and the RHS separately. So first, here UT into VT, UT into VT equals to multiply these two terms. So if you multiply these two terms, you will be getting, so first YT into YT, it is YT square. Next YT into minus eta to X. Eta to xt, so that can be written as minus eta to xt yt. Next, we will be multiplying the second term, that is minus eta 1 xt into yt. That is minus eta 1 xt yt. Next, minus eta 1 xt into minus eta 2 xt, minus into minus plus eta 1 eta 2 xt into xt xt square. Next, if you observe from these two terms, you can take xt and yt common. If you take minus xt and yt common, you will get eta 1 plus eta 2. So therefore, ut into vt equals to yt square minus eta 1 plus eta 2 into xt yt plus eta 1 eta 2 xt square. So this is equation 5. So now we have to take the summation over equation 5. So here you can write it as covariance of ut into vt equals to 0. That is, expectation of ut equals to 0. Expectation of vt is also equals to 0. Now we will take the summation over equation 5. Summation over, we are considering the time series data, so we will take summation over t to the equation 5. We get, what is the equation 5? That is equation 5. The summation over t ut into vt equals to summation over t yt square minus eta 1 plus eta 2 constant. You will be getting xt, the summation over t xt into yt plus eta 1 eta 2 summation over t xt square. So now we assume that these values are 0. So if we assume that covariance term is 0, so what is generally covariance formula? Covariance of x, y means 1 by n summation xi y I minus x bar y bar. So covariance term is 0 means this value is, we can consider as 0. That is summation xi y. So if covariance of ut, vt is 0, obviously summation ut, vt is also equals to 0. So hence covariance term is 0. Summation ut, vt value is also 0. So therefore we get the, so since you can write covariance of ut, vt equals to 0, which implies that summation over t ut into vt is equals to 0. So therefore we get, so what do we get? First, write this one to the left side, that is summation over t yt square minus eta 1 plus eta 2 into summation over t if you have two parameters means you have to have two equations, right? So in straight line also if you have two parameters AB, you will be having two normal equations. But here, how can we solve these equations? We want one more equation, right? So it is impossible to determine with one equation. So for that purpose, we will divide the total tangage, divide total range of time into two halves. So suppose if you have n time points by dividing half half. So 1 to n by 2 as first half, next n by 2 plus 1 to n as the second part. So for the first part, we will consider some summations. For the second part, we will be getting some summations. So by solving those two equations, we will be getting the required beta 1 and beta 2 values. So what is the, so from 6, so what are the parameters we are going to consider? So first one is T1 as from 1 to n by 2. If totally there are n values, we are getting T1 as 1 to n by 2 and T2 as n by 2 plus 1 to n. So now from 6, what we will be getting? First summation over T equals to 1 to n by 2 by T square minus beta 1 plus beta 2 summation over T equals to 1 to n by 2 xt into yt plus beta 1 beta 2 summation over T equals to 1 to n by 2 xt square. So this is equation 7. If you consider the second interval, what do you get? Summation over T equals to n by 2 plus 1 to n yt square plus beta 1 plus beta 2 summation over T equals to n by 2 plus 1 to n xt yt plus beta 1 beta 2 summation over T equals to n by 2 plus 1 to n xt square. So this is equation 8. So now by solving equation 7 and 8, we can estimate the beta 1 and beta 2 values. So if we substitute this beta 1 and beta 2 values in the demand and supply curve functions, we can estimate the parameter, we can estimate the demand function also. So this is about the Leontief's method. So this method is having some limitations also. So first limitation is that the assumption that demand and supply curve can shift in any direction independently. It is given that, so we are considering the both as yt because we are considering equilibrium price. So this is violating the equilibrium price. So both are shifting we are saying, but we took the equilibrium price. So this is the first limitation. Second one is, there is no way of testing the assumptions that elasticities of demand and supply curves are constants. We took the constant price elasticities, but we did not test it at all. And the last one is, this method assumes that supply and demand curves shift simultaneously. That is what the first limitation. So this is not a reasonable assumption. So this is all about the first method. Now we will see the second method, that is Pigel's method. Now coming to the second method. What is the second method? Is Pigel's method. P-I-G-O-U-S is spelled as Pigel's. So Pigel's method is also based on the time series data. The second method for estimating the demand function using the time series data is Pigel's method. So first we will see the assumptions of this method. So the first assumption is the demand curve is likely to have a plus IR minus IR gets cancelled. You will be getting plus R. So plus R here and plus R here gets cancelled. So if I bring all the terms on the left hand side, what I have here? One second. So there at the corner we have the equation 1. This you put it as equation 2. Now we will do equation 1 minus 2. 1 minus 2. So what is equation 1? That is yi plus 1 plus yi. That is on the left side, right? So write it down. Yi plus 1 minus yi. This is the first term. Equation 1 minus 2. So for equation 2, what is the left hand side? A into xi plus 1 minus xi minus A into xi plus 1 minus xi equals to. So there in the equation 1 we have on the right hand side as yi plus 2 minus yi plus 1 minus. Here we have on the right hand side A into xi plus 2 minus xi plus 1. So now from this we want the A value. So whatever the A values we have, I will write to the one side, and whatever the B values we have, we will write to the other side. So here I am bringing all the A terms to one side.
B equals to log C and A, X equals to log
coming to the limitations of Piper's method, this method is based on the assumption that the commodity is written in the form of x equals to f of p. So this assumes that the price of all related commodities have only no effect upon the commodity, but it is influencing. So in practice, it is possible to freeze all the other factors without first taking them into account. So without taking into account all the different factors, we can take only one factor. So this method breakdowns completely if the three successive sets of observations, that is three positive, that is three points quantity positions, we have seen that i plus 1 i plus 2. So if these three are collinear, that means lies on the same line, then this method fails because we are taking the difference. So if all are on the same line, then they are collinear, means we don't get the value. So this is all about today's class. We'll continue in the next.